Have you ever watched a bunch of YouTube videos like this, or attended a lecture only to forget what you just learned within a couple of hours? Hi, my name is Shang, and I help people and organizations think through their toughest problems. Today, I'm going to show you how I mind map real-time conversations, podcasts, interviews, and videos to get the most out of what I'm learning while remembering all the important details. Before we start, this exercise is actually the second part of Mind Map Nation's 7-day challenge to leveling up our mind mapping skills. If you're ready to take your mind mapping to the next level, then be sure to sign up to our weekly newsletter or check out our community. All right, let's hit it. So this is day two. The template that we're working with for the video mind map is we want to understand the speaker, right? Especially if we're going into this pretty cold. So let's say it's a podcast, YouTube video, or lecture. You want to understand who the name of the speaker is, as well as his or her background, and then the different topics break down throughout the entire talk, and then which then can be divided into subtopics. In our case, I came across this interview with Justin Welsh, right? And it's because I'm subscribed to this guy, Josh Spector, who runs a newsletter for creators. One of his emails caught my attention about, for example, how Justin runs a really good community as well as, you know, blowing up on LinkedIn and Twitter. So those are the two platforms that I am actually interested in, right? So I actually bookmarked this lecture or podcast for later. And now we're going to go through it and we're going to dissect it into a mind map form. So what we start is Justin Welsh interview. That's the first note, right? And then following our template, we've got speaker. I don't have any additional topics yet because I'm trying to understand who this guy is. And what I do immediately is go into the bio or the description of the video. And if you're looking at, let's say, a lecture or something like that, you know, look at the speaker bio section. Okay, so he looks like over the last decade, helped build 2x 50 million ARR, which stands for annual recurring revenue, companies, manages teams of 150 plus people, 300 million in funding. Very cool. Pretty impressive. All right, so what is he up to now? He is building a portfolio of one-person businesses. Now is portfolio advisor to SaaS startups. So, which is interesting. SaaS starts for software as a service. So any subscription-based companies are under SaaS. Dominating LinkedIn. Okay, so LinkedIn plus Twitter. Okay. And this seems to be the past, right? So I could even group it over here. There we go. All right. So already I have a much better idea of who this person is. So he seems to be an ex-techie who worked in, you know, has a SaaS background and has done a bunch of startups. If, you know, your video is timestamped, this is actually a perfect way to just understand the structure before you even start. And if you recall, our template has topic 1, 2, and 3. Well, this video actually is timestamped exactly that. So that is a great coincidence. So we have content system. Okay, content system. Community, repurposing, which is adapting content. So the other thing that I like to do, which is to actually rephrase, you know, what I'm reading or listening to into my own terms. This is super important for retention, right? Because adapting content to me is repurposing content. So I purposefully reword that into what I understand. Cool. All right. So already this whole structure is done. And this is actually part, like half the battle of starting a new mind map, which is, you know, what is the structure that we want to start with, right? Now that I've interacted with the Mind Map Nation community, one of the top things was literally just staring at a blank page and going like, hey, where do I start? Well, this template gives you that starting point. All right, now let's start the actual video. And in fact, since I already have a pretty good idea of who this person is, I can skip the intro and go directly into the content.
The first thing I want to know is you've got a lot of strengths, but the one that really jumps out to me as unique is your ability to systemize things as a creator and develop processes that work for you. It's something that I feel like I'm pretty good at, but every time I see the stuff you're doing, I'm like, oh wow, that's like next level. Can you give me an example or two of how you've created a system from start to finish? And in general, how do you identify where a system can help you? How do you start to construct one? How do you improve it once you roll it out? So talk to me about how you think about and use.
Yeah, well, I think first of all, I'm fortunate to come from an executive SaaS background where, you know, I got to build really big teams and big mm-hmm. companies in that. But there's all sorts of process and systems that go into building organizations at that scale. And so bringing that over to becoming sort of a solopreneur, creator, entrepreneur, it was just second nature for me. And I also think I'm in the situation where I don't have any employees. I have a virtual assistant, but she only does administrative customer service and support. She doesn't help with content or anything like that. So it's a function of being forced to have systems. And so because I come from the background, because it's forced, I have to build. And so I'll give you an example of maybe how I created one, how it changed over time, some of the mistakes, some of the learnings. That's mainly around my content. So let's think about my business, for example. My business.
All right. So I'm going to pause for a second because, you know, already there's even more structure coming along, right? He's mentioned that he's got a background in big companies. Now that he's a solopreneur, he's applying a lot of frameworks and stuff from that background, which is pretty important. And then we have content. Okay, content systems. Why a system? Well, he is still a solopreneur of sorts, right? So having systems which automate, hopefully, you know, a lot of his content creation, I think, is going to help a lot with that. Again, this is where constraints make us more creative because it's, you know, it forces us to, right? Anyways, let's, and then there's also, I heard creating systems, how it changes and how you sustain it. Let's see how it holds. Let's go.
Business runs on content. And in order for me to do more business, I have to promote and push out more content. The more content that I produce, generally, the better that my business does. The more I grow top of funnel followers on Twitter and LinkedIn, the more my newsletter grows, so on and so forth. So oftentimes when I'm sitting down, I might say, all right, what's a really unique challenge that I have being a content-driven one-person business? Well, it's a pretty easy one. It's creating massive amounts of fresh new content every single week for my audience. So when I saw that was a driver of business, I started to lay it out for the week. Okay, what are the things that I have to accomplish over the course of 1 week? So I have to push out a newsletter. So I have to do one newsletter, and that's generally a difficult thing to write. You write a newsletter, you know how difficult it can be, especially when you're just getting started. I also do 10 pieces of LinkedIn content, 10 pieces of Twitter content, a Twitter thread, a LinkedIn carousel. I also do 6 posts for my LinkedIn business account. So I've got 28 pieces of content and one newsletter that have to be produced every single week. And so
wait a minute, hold on.
Got 28 pieces of content and one newsletter that have to be produced every single week.
Wow, holy crap. 28 pieces of content per week. I don't know about you, man. That's insane.
And so when I'm thinking about what I want the outcome to be, those are the outcomes, those are the outputs of what I'm doing. Yep. And so I might just kind of put those down on a document and say, okay, we've got 20 short form posts, we've got a thread, a carousel, we've got 6 business posts, a newsletter, and I'll just start to rearrange them in a fashion that makes sense to me. And it may not make sense to everybody. It might just only make sense in my brain, but this is how I build sort of my own system. I think, all right, a lot of people write short form social media content and then they see what resonates and then they turn that into a newsletter. That didn't work for me. For whatever reason, it just didn't resonate with me. I couldn't figure that out. To me, it's the opposite. Generally, I found the newsletter to be most challenging, so I kind of move that towards the front of the system. The earlier in the week that I can finish my newsletter, comes out on Saturday, my intention is to finish it on Monday, okay? So it's like I pull the newsletter to the front, and then I think, okay, I've got 20 pieces of social media content left that I need to kind of create. So how can I create that, but also do it in a way that's extremely efficient? Well, I've got this newsletter, which is a robust piece of content. So how can I systematize turning that newsletter into 10 to 20 unique ideas? And so what I started to do was create a system where each newsletter can be pushed through 6 to 10 different lenses. And those lenses are things like a story, an observation, a contrarian take, a listicle, the past versus the present, present versus the future.
Whoa, that's a lot of good stuff there. So he's giving a breakdown of the different content types, right? So from one newsletter, this is how he's able to turn it into like 28 different pieces, which is kind of insane. By the way, I have closed captioning on, which is really helpful because then I can, you know, go back and
ideas.
And take so a look at, you know, what he's actually talking about and break it down and slow down
what
time.
What I started to do was create a system where each newsletter can be pushed through 6 to 10 different lenses.
Okay.
And those lenses are things like a story, an
observation,
a contrarian take, a listicle.
Contrarian take, listicle, funny word, oops.
The past versus the present versus the future, an analysis, a teardown. Like, there are so many different ways that you can take what you've just written.
Let's minimize this guy. Past versus present versus future.
This long form piece of content, push it through different lenses and learn how to say the same thing 1,000 different ways. And when you can say the same thing 1,000 different ways, you can create a bunch of different content. Plus, you're also helping people who learn different ways, right? Some people like motivational stories, other people like step-by-step educational guide. So by pushing the newsletter topic through that lens, out the end, or out the bottom, comes a bunch of different unique content. Okay, that's 20 different ways to create 20 different pieces of content. But what about the Twitter thread? Well, instead of writing a brand new Twitter thread, why not take the newsletter, copy and paste it, chunk it down, give it headers and subheaders, and turn the entire written piece of content into its own Twitter thread? So then it's like, I push it through that lens. Carousel, chop it up, download it into a bunch of PDFs.
Interesting, okay. So basically for Twitter, he is taking out, slicing snippets. Basically it's snippets with titles. Right, with cache titles, essentially. Interesting. I would love to see. So here's my follow-up question too, which is, what does this look like? And in fact, I should have probably gone into his bio initially anyways, you know, his Twitter, for example, Justin Welsh, right? So what does it actually mean? Potential unpopular opinion. So this is contrarian lens, right? That's already happening. This is kind of like, This is the past versus present format. What a book nobody talks about. Contrarian question. Very interesting. Okay. I think I'm getting a sense of that output, right? This is super, super important. So maybe I'll take a screenshot now of this. Let's see. Okay. So that's the beauty of having a digital map, is that you're able to just, you know, screenshot that and then have it right there. Okay, cool, snippets. All righty, let's go back to the original.
Put it on LinkedIn, let people go through the Twitter thread as a carousel. It's the same thing as a Twitter thread, just chopped up into a different format and distributed onto a different platform. So that's like PDFs. How I create all these different pieces of content off of one idea. So that's how the system started, Josh. But what happened was, I would wake up on Monday, the first time I went to run the system, and I'm like, gotta get the newsletter done, because that is the hub of this sort of hub and spoke model. And I sat down and I was like, what do I want to write about?
Minor jeans out.
Yeah, I was like, wait a minute. There's a missing piece here that I haven't thought through of the system. Anytime that I come up against friction, my brain says, like, how do you systematize removing friction? So it's like, okay, I need ideation in this system. How do you build ideation into a system? Well, the previous week, I want to make sure that I've ideated so frequently that I have this pool of ideas that I can pull from come Monday morning. So on Tuesday, Thursday of each week, I set aside 30 minutes each day to ideate. And to ideate, I might do things like...
Oh, fascinating. Okay, so he's now talking about the top of the funnel. This is actually the output, right? So he's backing up now into the actual creation. So we have incentive, and then we have, let's say, input, creative input. So creative input is ideation. So where does he get his content ideas to actually, you know, continue to produce? So right now we know that newsletter is probably the most challenging. It's a long form. It's probably the origins of all the other pieces of content, which is interesting enough. It's, you know, these are all the short form stuff. I'm more of a video creator, but I also have a newsletter. It's like, okay, well, how do you chop up all those words, right? All right, ideation, input.
Watch YouTube videos on some of my favorite creators' channels. Okay. Or look at their most popular videos. I'll open your For the Interested newsletter. Is there any interesting thing that you shared that resonates with me that I could put a different spin on, that I could put my take on, that stuck out as a topic? I'll look at my RSS feeds, my Readwise. So I've built that in. And now I have step one, ideation, right? And that took place of just writing the newsletter, because you have to ideate first. So the next week I went to do it, I ideated, picked a topic, went to write, and I was like, I need to include some more robust things in this newsletter. It can't just be my opinion. So I added a research step. And as I'm building these all out, I'm building them in Notion, where I create this entire content operating system that I can open up on a Monday and literally walk through step by step, and out the bottom comes a newsletter and 28 pieces of content. So it went from being just like newsletter and content to
So just now, you know, he broke out his creative input flow with ideation, which of all of these sources, and then he's got the research phase where, you know, it's not just pulling out of that, right? Like, or just hearsay, because that would just be not very value added, or even plagiarism. So you basically have to research your side, which then he uses Notion, which I also use. I'm putting second brain here because this is something that I've been exploring, a concept to, you know, accelerate my own learning, but also remembering stuff. So
ideation, research, newsletter. And then one Thursday I came around and I said, crap, I forgot to edit this. Well, how do I want to edit my newsletter? Let's systematize it. What are six questions? What are four questions? What are three questions that I should ask myself to...
Interesting. Okay. So this is, sounds like it's the bridge, right? This is the actual system now. Questions.
To go through a proper editing process. That list grows and grows and grows. Then the content operating system changes. Ideation, research, newsletter, editing, thread, content. And it just becomes longer and longer and longer. But by the time I'm done, I have a 10-step process. And now each Monday morning, I can open up step one. And by the end of the day, I can create a newsletter. I can create two pieces of promotional content, 20 pieces of short form content, a thread, a carousel, and six business posts. Simply by following the instructions on my screen, because when I don't feel motivated, creative, excited, that's where systems come in. And that's why I build them. First of all, for everyone that's listening and
Hold on, pretty important. So templates, right? And also, you know, this explains why systems. Again, this is, you know, going back to motivation, right? So it's not about the motivation, it's about the system. So our motivation as a creator, or just anything, right? It might actually falter. So you basically rely on this, like, you know, tried and true method in order to get yourself to actually producing stuff. So anyways, this is why system, because it actually generates content. And I like actually having an arrow here just to help me understand why I should have a system as well, to make it personal. So template questions, right? Then my question is, you know, what are these? I'm curious about what he asks in order to create those outputs. So again, as I'm mapping this out, I'm constantly asking myself questions so that I'm engaged. That's actually one of the powers, advantages of mind maps, is that, you know, for example, I'm asking these questions, but sometimes I also see where what he's talking about fits somewhere else that I've already asked, right? So, you know, why systems? Well, that just answered it. And this is a very nonlinear way of actually approaching learning, because in a real life meeting or podcasts or lectures, it's not lectures so much as, like, you know, podcasts, it's very nonlinear, right? People jump around topics all the time. So you have to be able to capture, you know, bits of information and see where it fits too. So I like the question and answer format.
I told you he was master of system. So that is a fantastic answer, and I'm sure people will find that really helpful. A couple things that I just want to highlight or point out about that. One, the idea, and I'm assuming you're going to agree with this, but tell me if you do. but the idea that systems are always evolved. It's not like you make a system and you're done. They're always evolving, right? Mm-hmm. The second being, I love what you said about friction, and anytime you encounter friction, that being the sort of trigger to like, okay, maybe the system's missing a piece. Maybe this is where I need to figure a system to address that friction. Because I think a lot of people maybe don't know sort of where to start or where, I think looking for friction is a great sort of piece of that. The other thing that I love is that you're, because I found this for myself, and when I talk to people, I think this is a huge part of systems as well, that you're not, your system's not topic specific. That what you're talking about is formats, and even when it's content, right, the sort of before, after, the whatever, that you're creating these sort of boxes that you can apply, or templates that you can apply to just about any topic. And I think a lot of people start the other way and go, what am I gonna write about? What am I gonna talk about? They have a list of topics, but they haven't thought about the system from the sort of format.
Actually, you know, I just noted a few things over here too. It's actually scalable, but that belongs to, again, why systems, again. What I like to do, what you probably notice, is that I don't write out the entire thing of what they're saying. That would actually take way too long. What I like doing is actually just listening for keywords that resonate with me. You know, it's a little bit difficult to explain because I'm a very deep listener, and what I pick up are these like little tidbits of just like, you know, ping. It's like, oh, okay, points of friction. You know, it's like, they're talking about how a system changes or evolves over time. Well, what causes it to evolve? Well, it's points of friction. You're looking for things to optimize over time, right? Or, you know, making it more scalable, for example. Anyways, these are like the tidbits I'm looking for, so I'm not writing out entire paragraphs of what I'm listening to. I'm just taking out the key words and the key concepts that really resonate, so I can go back to, and at a glance, I'm gonna know exactly what it means for points of friction, or why system, because it's scalable, it overcomes motivation issues. So anyways, let's get back to it.
Generic box type, right? They're just making lists of, I wanna talk about this or whatever. And they're not, they kind of think they're building a system, but that's actually a true system is probably independent of any content that go into it.
Yeah, I think it's really interesting because if you look at my Twitter content, it looks different every day. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it looks similar. Like there are definitely formats that I go back to, styles and structures that work for me and things like that. But you wouldn't see the system on the surface level. Like, it's not like you can scroll through my Twitter and be like, I see this system. And you can't, because there's so many different lenses through which you can push content through. And I always get sort of this feedback or maybe like a contrarian take on systems from other people. Like, doesn't that take the authenticity away? Won't everyone be the same? I mean, tell me a creative profession that doesn't have system, right? So like, I like movies. They all go through the exact same plot, whether it's Star Wars or whether it's Lord of the Rings. It's, you know, a guy meets a guy, it overcomes a challenge. Like, it's the same thing done through a different lens. You don't see it as an audience. You don't notice that it's all the same. Music, they all have similar beats, similar backgrounds, similar hi-hats. Like, that's why you see a lot of artists say, I think this artist took this from me. And it's like, this is the same sound in 30,000 other songs. Every creative process has a template.
Yeah, and also they, even wildly creative people, right? So you might look at, like, let's take someone like Prince, who might seem like he's pure creativity, you know, amplified, had a process for how he would record. Yeah, he might go record an album in a different location each time, whatever, but there, I am sure there were things that he was doing every time and the way he thought about creating.
By the way, I'm not taking any notes right now because I've already internalized this. I've also accepted the fact that, you know, creativity is simply combining things, right? It's not copying necessarily, but it's actually combining different aspects of things. So that's why I'm just going like, oh, okay, no, that sounds about right. I'm only taking down notes of things that I don't know yet, which is really the foundation of learning.
The music that on some level was systematized, right?
All right.
your take on membership communities and in particular paid membership. It's interesting because I see so many people trying to start them and they fall in love with the idea of recurring subscription revenue, which is understandable. And I do think memberships can be very helpful. And I, at times I think about starting one and I go back and forth, you know, and ultimately have not really done it up to this. But you have an interesting sort of perspective on this because you had built and launched and grew a really successful paid membership community and ultimately decided to shut it down. And I'm curious why you made that, two things. One, why you ultimately made that decision when it was quote unquote working. And then also what you learned from building a successful community. What do you think were the keys to growing it? And, you know, what advice would you have for people that do want to do that?
Yeah, maybe.
Wow, this is super interesting, right? Like, you know, my ears immediately perked up where he says successful, but shut down.
Maybe I'll start with why I think it went well. I think community all starts with sort of focused conversation and focused outcomes. So it's not the Justin Welch community. It's a community of creators and solopreneurs who want to build a different lifestyle, who want to build one-person businesses. We're all aiming at the same target. We're all trying to achieve the same goal. And I think goal alignment in community is what makes community really purposeful. But it's more than just goal alignment. It's also everyone has to have the same context. And so what I mean by that is generally I've found the best communities that I'm a part of, it's not just we're all aiming at the same outcome or we all joined because we like the creator who's running the community, but we've all gone through a similar journey. And that journey is usually in a self-paced course, a cohort-based coaching program, where we can all speak the lingo, talk the jargon, talk about the things that we've learned in a space that is a community. So it's not just about goal alignment. It's also about we've all been on a similar journey and we all have the same context in reaching that goal. I think if you can get those two things right, those are major things. And of course, there's a lot of nuance in there and small things that I haven't, you know, talked about, but those are the two big ones. And for me, I got one of those things right, which was we had goal alignment. I didn't think to take people who had gone through a specific course or program of mine and put them into a community where they could all talk using that similar jargon, lingo, and sort of context. That's not why I shut my community down. My community, even though it didn't have that second part, was thriving. 14K MRR business, more importantly, everybody loved it, liked it, everyone was resubscribing. For me, it was just a lifestyle choice. And when you make a commitment to a community, you drastically reduce optionality. So if you sign people up for a year, you're a year away from being able to shut that down if it's something that you don't enjoy. If you sign them up for 3 months, you're 90 days away. And what I realized is when I opened it for a year, I tethered myself to a 12-month commitment. Now, I enjoyed the community a lot, actually. I made some really great friends. We did some really great events, one of them. But in the end, I wanted to be able to spend my time in a more efficient way. I want to build more courses. I want to write a book. I want to potentially do a cohort-based coaching program. I want to build a micro SaaS. There are so many things that I want to do. And my personality didn't lend itself well to synchronous community. Meaning, if I had a 3-hour block of open time from noon to 3 on my calendar, I'd like to be able to use that to make strategic decisions and drive a big project forward. Instead, what happened was the community existed. It was always there on Slack. So as soon as I had that free time, it wasn't free time anymore. I wanted to go in, chat with everybody, drop a video, create some content. So it's almost like you never had a day off. And because I had people from 61 different countries, I never really had an hour off. Everyone was awake at some point in time.
Yeah.
So I made this difficult decision to shut it down and take my time back, take some of my peace of mind back, and just pursue different opportunities.
Did you consider...
This is really, really cool, right? So just with that breakdown, I'm already understanding or empathizing because now as a community manager, a new community manager, I now know it's like, oh, okay, yes. You know, it's obviously not about the founder. That's not how you make a community sustainable. There's only one of me, many of the members, right? I can't possibly, you know, respond to everybody, especially when the community is growing massively. So goal alignment, I get it. You know, it's ultimately about the members. It's really like the community exists for the membership. My Map Nation exists because people want to reduce chaos, want to manage chaos, want to make sense of it, right? They want to achieve their long-term goals. They want to live more intentionally. They want to have a sense of purpose. So all that is aligned, right, with My Map Nation. And context-wise, I think so too. I mean, I think I got this, which is by far most of my members come from my YouTube channel, right? You guys, and who have watched my mind mapping videos and understand where I'm coming from, the lingo, the jargon that I use, nodes, for example, right? And expanding complexity, all that stuff. So I think all of this, you know, checks out, right? Which is really positive. And then not well, well, lifestyle choice. Interesting. Reduce the optionality. That makes sense. Opportunity cost, no day off, all these things make sense. But I think it's all about, you know, your personal choice, right? For me, when I made My Map Nation, I wanted to co-create with other people. And, you know, after quitting tech and all this stuff, it's been a lonely journey of sorts, right? I've always worked with teams within teams and stuff. And now with, you know, a community, it's awesome because I'm now able to bounce ideas off. I'm able to create a home for others. And it's very rewarding in its own way. And at the same time, I also have to set boundaries, which actually right after the first launch week, which is craziness with actions and stuff, I actually told everybody, hey, I'm actually going to shut down all my electronics this weekend so that I can actually reflect on all the significant happenings, occurrences that happened during that week, right? Because otherwise, it's just like onto the next, things just flow by and you don't really appreciate all these monumental things. So anyways, lifestyle choice, totally get it too. Really, really good, you know, context. But again, out of that, you know, 5 minute or 3 minute, whatever, I've only jotted down these words again, because each of these words represent a lot of things. So I'm not writing down the paragraphs.
At all. To what extent do you think that the community was about you versus the community being about each other? Right? Like, do you think there's, and you can talk specifically about you, but also just in general, because I think this is another thing that a lot of people get confused about when they're starting communities, right? Like, are people in that community really for access to the creator of that community, or are they in that community for access to the community itself, right? And my guess is, I could be wrong, but my guess is a lot of your community was people that were drawn to you. Yes, they connected with each other and they loved that. But to your point, if you were to try to step back, my guess is their perception of the value of the community would probably go down significantly.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think what attracted them to the community was potentially me. I don't mean to have that sound arrogant, but I think that's probably part of the attraction. I think it'd be foolish to say it wasn't. I think once they got inside, what really keeps people in a community is connecting them with one other meaningful person. If you can do that, like, people feel like community is really strong. The events were great. When I went to fold it down, I gave everybody a 90-day notice, which I wanted to make sure that we didn't pull the rug out from underneath anyone. And people were overwhelmingly disappointed, right? They understood because I had dropped hints at it before, but they asked, could we keep it open? Could we all just chat? I think when you haven't built a community and cobbled together the technology, people fail to recognize the amount of work it is to keep it moving. Yeah. I can't figure out my Luma password. I don't know how to get into, you know, read the emails. How do I log into outside? Like it's just a lot of customer service. And so even leaving it open, making it free and allowing it to live on would have been a pretty full-time customer service role for me or perhaps my wife or the sort of combination of the two of us. So we just made the decision to shut it down completely. And a lot of folks ask, could they create their own community? And I said, hey, as long as it's not related to my name, my brand, you want to solicit folks out of this community, be my guest. I wanted them to have a place to go. Mm-hmm.
Can you share the way that you charged? Because I thought what you did was a little different than what most people do, which is sort of monthly or annual, whatever. I actually thought it was really smart. So you want to just sort of tell people how you handle pricing, inscriptions.
Yeah, I started with an annual plan, and I enrolled a cohort, then a second cohort, then a third cohort. And as I started to consider optionality, I recognized that was a bad idea because each cohort extended my my, you know, commitment to the project another 12 months. And I never wanted to say like, hey, we're shutting this down and like giving you a refund. I just don't like that. I like to see through a commitment. And so after a while, I moved to quarterly memberships. And to me, quarterly memberships are the sweet spot. And if I were to ever do a community again, that's what I would do. I think monthly memberships allow people to come in, kick tires for 2 seconds and then exit. It's not a hotel. I didn't want to build that hotel environment, but a year is on the other side for the creator, the person running the community, again, kind of drastically reduces that optionality. So for me, the quarterly membership was a sweet spot. It allowed me to always be 90 days away from saying, hey, this is no longer something that I'm interested in doing. But it also committed the member to kind of coming in for 90 days, understanding the channels, attending some events, making some friends, and getting entrenched in the community. So I felt like that was an absolutely right way to price it, and I would recommend that other folks price it that way as well.
Yeah, I think that's really smart. And I think the other thing that quarterly does is it forces buyers, again, to make enough of a commitment to actually give the community a chance to provide value to them. But it also makes it, they don't have to make an annual commitment, which means the price is less. So it makes it easy to ask growing an audience on LinkedIn. I think over a couple of years, had built up a massive audience.
All right, so that basically completes the whole community aspect of it, right? Josh, the moderator, is now moving into the fourth topic, which is LinkedIn and Twitter.
It's there. I hadn't really used Twitter at all. And then I'm guessing in the past year or two, you sort of jumped over to Twitter and have taken off very quickly there and had a lot of success. But I think it gives you a unique perspective. So I'm curious, what's your advice for someone who's maybe active on LinkedIn and now thinking of going into Twitter, and vice versa, someone who's active on Twitter and thinking of going into LinkedIn? What do you see about those platforms that are similar? What have you noticed is different, and how have you sort of adapted to each platform? Because you've managed to have a lot of success.
Yeah, I went LinkedIn to Twitter, and a lot of folks I see on Twitter are going to LinkedIn right now. And I don't think they're that dissimilar, right? I think like it is a group of creators, and there is a group of consumers, and there is a feed, right? Like. Those things are all pretty similar, but sure, there are definitely some differences. So maybe I'll talk through those. So LinkedIn is highly professional, as you can probably imagine. It leans more towards practical content, practicality, emotion, whereas Twitter, at least in my echo chamber of Twitter, right? And I know all echo chambers on Twitter are different. Twitter leans a little bit towards more towards being interesting, philosophical, unique. There's a lot of Naval-esque, Sahil Lavinia-esque sort of content on there that's like, you know, creative one-liners, make you think kind of stuff. Yeah, that like plays well on LinkedIn, but LinkedIn, people are there to learn how to get better at their job. And I think a lot of Twitter creators come over and they use a similar sort of pithy format that they might use on Twitter to be interesting or unique or ironic or whatever you want to call it. And it doesn't play well on LinkedIn. LinkedIn is just like, practical and tactical. How do I get better at my job? And outside of practical and tactical, it's very emotional. It's very inspirational. It's very story driven. Whereas Twitter is, I think, more unique and interesting. And I don't mean that LinkedIn is unique and interesting, but Twitter, you have to be unique and interesting in order to stand out. And so I think that's just maybe a primary difference. I think the secondary difference is LinkedIn gives you 3,000 characters where Twitter gives you 280. And also LinkedIn, much like a thread, every post has a...
Whoa, 3,000 characters, format, 280 characters. The other thing that I was going to note is the nature of it is really interesting, right? Like LinkedIn is really practical content, you know, emotional, inspirational. I would say that this really matches up to the houses of My Map Nation, which we've got, you know, tactical masterminds, which I literally was like, oh, this is really for my LinkedIn crowd, right? This is like, you know, domain expertise or specific problems that you're trying to solve. Let's see, so tactical masterminds, and I would say probably creative geniuses as well, mainly because this is where, you know, like capturing all your creativity and productivity. So creative geniuses. Whereas interesting philosophical, well, this is definitely the strategy nerds who really geek out at the 10,000 foot level of all the strategy stuff. The reason why I'm labeling this again is because, you know, the way that we can remember things, especially with mind maps, is when we associate it to something that we already know. This is how knowledge and functional knowledge actually builds. What makes it much more meaningful in terms of remembering what type of content that LinkedIn is mapping it literally to, you know, what resonates really with me, right? Again, I'm always just trying to get out what resonates with me because that's the only way that I'm going to remember. Okay, going back to here.
Characters where Twitter gives you 280, and also LinkedIn, much like a thread, every post has a header where you have to click see more in order to see the remainder of the post. So writing long form on LinkedIn is almost like writing a Twitter thread every day when you write content there. So I think learning that style of teasing out the rest of the content through, you know, hook lines, through scroll stopping lines, through unique lines at the top, it is a different style than being pithy and witty inside of 280 characters. So if I were going from LinkedIn to Twitter, what I did was I took all of my content from LinkedIn and I compressed it. I took things that were generally longer and I put them into short bulleted structures, easy on the eyes, a lot of white space, short sentences, and that seemed to play really well on Twitter. When I see people come from Twitter to LinkedIn, what I see them do really well is they take those threads, and I put them into short bulleted structures, easy on the eyes, a lot of white space, short sentences, and that seemed to play really well on Twitter. When I see people come from Twitter to LinkedIn, what I see them do really well is they take those threads, they move them into a LinkedIn post, they've got 3,000 characters to play with, and generally it's a type of content that people really like, educational, step-by-step, how to do something. Also, if something's working really well on Twitter.
Okay. So type of content is educational, tutorial, right?
Twitter in 280 characters, bring that over to LinkedIn. Bring your entire catalog of popular tweets over to LinkedIn and it's generally going to play well, but keep it professional, keep it tight. There's not a lot of trolling on LinkedIn. It's just a different environment, but it's also consumer heavy. Everyone is tweeting. On LinkedIn, everyone is consuming. Mm. And so to me, that's why it is such a valuable channel for audience growth, income growth, business growth. And so I think a lot of people, after seeing my success on that platform, are coming over and recognizing what I recognized in 2019, which was a lot of luck, by the way. But, you know, I saw an opportunity, and I think they're seeing that as well. So those are just maybe some short differences, but things that I noticed.
Do you feel like, for example,
So what I like doing is, you know, he said something extremely profound just now, that LinkedIn is consumer heavy, as in consuming, right? Like people actually read a lot of things, but not many people actually post things. Whereas on Twitter, anybody from anywhere can just throw a thought and that's it, right? It's far easier to create and therefore you have more creators on Twitter. So that's a really key dynamic, which means, you know, this is actually a really important thing as a creator myself to know that ratio. And what I like doing with that highlight is actually bolding it, right? This is something that is, extremely important to just note. If I really wanted to, I can also make this a different color, which I sometimes do, right? Consuming heavy, creator heavy. That's another alternative. But sometimes just for brevity's sake, I just bold it and it's just easy to tell from all the regular text.
Say someone's on Twitter and let's say they have a successful tweet, but it's short, right? It's a couple sentences. So when you were saying bring that over to LinkedIn, would you recommend when they do that, they expand it? This is, I guess, sort of a formatting question, but that one or two sentence tweet that did really well, would you make the LinkedIn version of that the same, or would you try to expand it to give it a little more length or LinkedIn?
Depends. From a copywriting perspective, I would look at the piece of content and I would want to know one of two things. Either it's one, the other, or both. So let me kind of try and explain what I mean. So oftentimes, if you look at a piece of content on Twitter that's one or two lines, the brevity of it is part of why it was popular. Because you took because you took something. The other side is the content, the actual content itself.
Right.
What did I actually say, right? If you can take something really unique, interesting, and powerful and put it into something that is extraordinarily short, the two of those things generally play together well because people can just consume it in 2 seconds and they're like, oh, that was really mind-blowing, a really unique or interesting perspective. So if it's both the brevity and the content together that makes it popular, you can bring that over to LinkedIn, keep the short length and keep the content. If it is generally, you think that only the content and that the brevity didn't play into the popularity of the post, and you think it's the idea or what was presented in it that really made it popular, there's no problem in bringing that over to LinkedIn and expanding on that, adding additional information, adding a call to action or a call to conversation, making it more robust, teaching a little bit more. Those things play really well on LinkedIn. What I tend to do, Josh, to be candid, is if I have a piece of content on Twitter that's 280 characters, I'll generally bring it over to LinkedIn, and then I'll also bring it again 3 months later with more content added inside of it. Use that as two different posts, review that in Shield Analytics, see which one played well, and then store that again for a 6 month repurpose. So the answer is less about what I say and more about what the data says. That's how I think about it.
And what about, obviously none of these platforms and none of these algorithms are big fans of people sharing links, right? And so in general, I hardly ever do it. I pretty much tell people it's kind of not worth it. But I'm curious, in your experience, do you find, if you had to share a link, do you find either Twitter or LinkedIn to be a little better in terms of what you get out of it?
Yeah, I do. I feel like
a little more link friendly, I guess.
Yeah, I think LinkedIn is more link friendly. So here's what I've been doing. People say, oh, it kills impressions. And that's true, by the way. But let me give you an example. My average post, I think, gets 150,000 impressions. And when I put a link in, it might get 70K. So let's, to keep this simple, let's call it. People say...
All right. So here's the other thing you notice. I was going to actually create a new node, link sharing, but I realized, you know, he's talking about comparisons between LinkedIn and Twitter, and I already have those nodes. So I'm just going to put it into type. But really, type is no longer the right term. So I go back and change it into tactics, right? Because I think tactics is a better thing than or term to describe what I'm actually trying to say. Tactics.
Oh, it kills impressions, and that's true, by the way. But let me give you an example. My average post, I think, gets 150,000 impressions, and when I put a link in, it might get 70K. So let's to keep this simple, let's call it 50% reduction in impressions, right? But the click-through rate on the post is about 7x what it would normally be if I instead said, go find this in my featured section, or go find this in my profile, or, you know, I spelled out Justin Welsh /me, and I tried to all that stuff completely eliminates the likelihood that someone's going to click through. So what I found is, people are sharing all this information on LinkedIn. Don't put links, it kills impressions. Don't put links, it kills impressions. But my business doesn't run on impressions. My business runs on money. And so, like, when I talk about my newsletter or my products or my services, I'm going to link to those. Like, sure, it's not gonna get the impressions, but I'm gonna get so much web traffic. And because so few people are doing it, I'm standing out as the guy who's dropping links, and I drop my link in my content five times a week on LinkedIn. And when I do that, yeah, I get far
in the actual post itself, or you just mean in the comments?
In the actual post itself.
So that's 5 out of how many posts you do on LinkedIn?
10 to a 12.
So almost 50% of your posts have a link in them? Interesting.
That's right. The link is never an ask, so it's never an aggressive ask. It's never a buy my course. It's not what I do is...
Okay. All right. Now he's going into specifics, right? So I'm going to say link friendly, performance, and then tactics. And this is what I like to regroup in real time sometimes, right? So links, tactics, this is the actual things that he does.
Using my content system, I chop up my newsletter. So maybe I'll write a newsletter about how to build an online course. And so once I have the topic, I'll push it through those lenses we talked about earlier, and out the back end will come a story, an observation, a contrarian take, all these different things. So let's take the story, for example.
All right. So this is pretty important because this is actually coming from newsletter, lenses, LinkedIn. Yep, lenses. I'm going to actually, as you notice, I already have that lenses going from, you know, newsletter. What do we got? Yeah, newsletter to LinkedIn. But now I'm actually going to link it below so that I know this is related. Where is that? Ah, here it is. Repurpose from newsletter using Lens.
So how to build an online course first 90 days, whatever. I'll tell a story about that. So here's a story about a course that I built. And I'll tell the story, I'll make it educational, I'll make it a relatively long piece of content because I want to bring the reader from top to bottom. The more likely they are to get to, if they get to the bottom, they're much more likely to do something interesting. 4,000 people a day to that newsletter issue that exists on my website. And then on my website, they'll read through the newsletter issue. And at the bottom of the issue, I passively offer up all the services that I have. Hey, by the way, here are three ways I can help you. This course, this service, whatever. And so I do that every single day on LinkedIn. In fact, it just, interesting. So one last quick thing here.
So here is kind of the process, right, that he does. And this is where my maps are really, really good because it's essentially a flowchart. Is that once he repurposes from newsletter, and if he has a call to action to, let's say, you know, how I did it, and if you want the more robust version of this article, then go to my newsletter and website, which then he's able to, that's basically a lead gen, what we call in this industry, and he's able to sell essentially courses, right?
Let's just say hypothetically, someone, let's say they're a coach or a consultant or whatever, they don't use social media that much, but they're sort of just starting to, they're trying to figure out, they're going to start with one platform, and they say, Justin, should I start on Twitter or LinkedIn? What do you say to them?
Yeah, I mean, I think it depends on where their audience plays. So like, for example, if you're a coach and you work in B2B SaaS, or you work in sales development, or you work in marketing or customer success or executive leadership, those are great places to go for LinkedIn. Definitely. You work in fitness and health, you're a trainer, that's Twitter. I'm not going to find that. People aren't on LinkedIn looking for that type of content. At least that's my opinion. Maybe some facts will say I'm incorrect, but I've generally seen platform specific by where users hang out. So I would say, like, look where your users are. Are your users, you know, professional folks who are looking to get their, to do better in their job? Go to LinkedIn. Is it a more niche topic area, health and fitness, crypto, you know, whatever the space might be, that's a better Twitter play, in my opinion.
Would you agree? I typically tell people start with one platform.
Yes.
Would you agree start with one? As I think people start with too many. And
I was on LinkedIn for 3 years. You know, I started on Twitter October 25th of last year. Built my following up to 200,000 plus before I even dropped really my first sort of week's worth of Twitter content.
Cool. Mm. Well, thank you so much for all of this. Tell people where they can find you and see your systems in action.
So I think that basically wraps it up. Right. If you take a look at this mind map now, because we have already reached the end of that podcast, right? It's pretty ginormous-ish because that's how electronic or digital mind mapping apps go. But if I just reformat it a little bit, we have quite a few good information, right? This is the speaker, who this Josh or this Justin person is. And then content system, that's the first thing he talked about, right? How he generates so much content with just one newsletter and basically no team using systems. And then we've got LinkedIn, or not, that's actually later. Let's see, the community, right? What he learned about community, why he shut it down ultimately, what are the trade-offs, right? What are the advantages? And then we have LinkedIn and Twitter, which is fascinating. I really got a lot out of this because now, you know, these are literally the things I'm involved with, right? Content creation, community management, and then getting on, expanding into LinkedIn or Twitter. I haven't really made up my mind yet, so we'll see. So this was actually really, really cool. And now that I can go back and I can see, you know, where the arrows are, so I'm not missing a lot of the important connections, right? Otherwise, it's just like separate items floating around and stuff. I can really see that process. As well as going back to the colors and bolding, right? That completes our walkthrough. If you found this video helpful, be sure to check out my other tutorials on mapping real-time meetings. As always, thank you so much for joining me. And until next time, take care.